Once forgiven, now free. Here's my entry in your challenge to prove that evolution is a fact. I'm going to come at this from an angle you may not have seen anyone present. And that's because I've spent my career working with the kind of reproducing things we can't observe directly, the viruses. And my primary work was with the evolution of the non-primate lentiviruses. This is a topic I can do off the top of my head. Many of the papers I can cite either contain data I produced or are by colleagues and friends of mine. Let's start with what we know about lentiviruses. This little guy you may have seen. This is the human immunodeficiency virus type 1. You are, I hope, familiar with the consequences of infection by this pathogen. HIV is the primary cause of AIDS. Why then is AIDS a recent phenomenon in our history? Where was it prior to the previous century? Where did it come from? Can we trace its ancestry? The reason I'm using HIV and its cousins is because it's so well documented. It is the most studied virus ever. There's a computer database at the old Los Alamos nuclear facility that documents HIV sequence variations, their relationships to each other, and their provenance. We have samples to sequence that reconstruct pretty much the full history of this virus's existence on Earth. Here then is a perfect opportunity to answer some basic questions. Do reproducing things evolve? Do they evolve in response to specific signals in their environment? And lastly, do they acquire new abilities as a result of this repeated process of directed change? In addition, viral evolution is something that happens on a massively accelerated scale. A viral generation might only be a matter of a few days, or at most a few months. It's also subject to selective criteria, the patient's immune system, that we understand very well and can monitor. It has also begun to respond to antiviral medications, and we've been able to test the limits of how much it can change, that is, the limits of evolution to innovate. Lastly, we have a very detailed history of the distant cousins of HIV that covers all of human history. As I'll show, there are three scales of evolutionary history that are well documented. The macroevolution of the human tropic virus from an ancestral virus, the microevolution of a virus from its origins in the early 1900s, and the, well, let's call it nanoevolution of HIV within a single infection in a single patient. All three of these scales of change are caused by the same processes, and we can't find any hard boundaries or differences in mechanism between these three phases of change. Now, Once Forgiven is welcome to come up with a God-based explanation for how HIV came to be. He can suppose that his God created HIV a few decades ago, but he's going to have to explain a few ethical issues, a few theological issues, and quite a lot of biological issues around such a recent creation. If he goes with an explanation that involves his particular God creating an early precursor of HIV, he's still going to have to admit that HIV has acquired, while we watch, the ability to infect humans. That's a new property. That's the gain of ability, or if you prefer, the poorly defined characteristic, gain of information, as a result of the forces which we know act on viruses while we watch. In the case of HIV, models of evolution have saved lives. They've advanced knowledge, they've produced treatment strategies, guided our diagnostics. Creationists may wonder why scientists so fiercely defend evolution when it's attacked. Evolution actually matters. It can even be a matter of life or death. If creationists could ever come up with a predictive and explanatory model to produce better diagnostics and therapeutic approaches to cancer, AIDS, and tuberculosis, it would be a useful first step in proving their position. In 200 years, though, the best they've come up with are questions and doubts. They are the jeering benchwarmers of science, not the opposing team. So let's start with how evolution acts on HIV on a nanoscale, that is, within a single patient during the course of the infection. You may be aware that HIV vaccine efforts so far have been unsuccessful. That's because HIV is so diverse and evolves so quickly that any attempt at traditional vaccine approaches ends up only driving the virus to some new form, and even accelerating infection and transmission. The most successful approaches will likely have to involve a vaccine in the body that evolves to match HIV's evolution. There are common and uncommon evolutionary changes in a single HIV infection. The common ones are all around how HIV enters the cell. The uncommon ones are around how the immune system detects the virus. Let's say we have a mother in South Africa who is HIV positive. That's all too common a story there. Her child is born HIV negative, but during the course of breastfeeding, the virus is released in the milk, travels to the vulnerable gut, and infects the newborn. That virus was what we call an R5 tropic virus form. R5 because it has a preference for a marker on the surface of immune cells called CCR5, chemokine receptor 5. The vulnerable gut or mucosa are loaded with these CCR5 containing cells, while they're less abundant in the blood. Later in the newborn, the R5 tropic virus will evolve to also include the X4 tropic form. This HIV form can also utilize the CXCR4 receptor to enter cells. Now the virus can spread beyond the tissues in the gut to enter the blood and spread throughout this young, vulnerable body, ensuring that the virus will cause an eventual collapse of the immune system and progress to AIDS. In the case of our young baby, her life expectancy is likely going to be very short, on the order of 3 years or fewer, and they'll likely be lived mostly in the ICU, as infection after infection ravages her compromised body. So X4 and R5 tropisms are one case of viral genetic diversity that produces a selective advantage for the virus, allowing it to spread through one type of immune cell but cause disease through another. This was the common nanoevolutionary change. There are also uncommon changes, and this is how HIV evades our immune system. The outer surface of HIV is made from the lipid membrane of the cell it emerged from. It's a bit like that gory scene in Silence of the Lambs where Hannibal Lecter covers his own face with the bloody skin of a fallen guard. HIV looks to our immune system remarkably like one of our own cells. However, it needs to have a way to enter new cells. So sticking through that lipid membrane are envelope proteins, made from the virus's envelope gene. These are foreign proteins, and our immune system is prepared to react to them like we would to any other invader. However, these proteins are so variable that by the time our immune systems start making the appropriate antibodies, say a few days after they're first detected, the virus has already undergone what can be called an antigenic variation shift. HIV is a sloppy copier. Only 1 in 100 virus particles that emerge from the cell are made in the same manner as the initial infection copy. Many are non-functional, non-infectious, but some are also random variations from the parent virus. Just enough of this variation is beneficial to the virus that a single immune response never clears the virus. During the later stages of HIV infection, what is defined as pre-AIDS, the dominant envelope form can change on a weekly basis, allowing it to avoid complete clearance by the immune system. This is ultimately what leads to AIDS, as the immune tissues, like the spleen and thymus, become depleted, trying to respond to each new variation, and opportunistic infections result in a funeral.